This video is on romosozumab, which is the newest and latest anti-osteoporosis drug. It is a monoclonal antibody and has emerged along with the monoclonal antibody revolution. The other osteoporosis monoclonal antibody was denosumab. Romosozumab was FDA approved in the US in 2019 and then in 2022 in the UK, so it is a fairly new drug. It is an anti-sclerostin monoclonal antibody. Sclerostin is secreted by osteocytes, which inhibits osteoblasts and thus bone formation. So there is an interesting backstory behind romosozumab. There is a very rare genetic condition found in Afrikaners in South Africa called sclerostiosis, where due to a gene mutation, their bodies don't produce sclerostin. And this was causing their bodies to keep building bone with no resorption, which causes bone overgrowth with large and dense bones, which are very resistant to fracture. So the discovery of the mechanism behind the sclerostiosis went on to spark the idea of creating a monoclonal antibody to target sclerostin in order to treat osteoporosis, and the result was romosozumab. Romosozumab has both anabolic and anti-resorptive activity and increases bone mineral density and reduces fracture risk. It is the most potent of all the anti-osteoporosis drugs so far, able to give higher BMD gains than the other agents, although not so much for the wrist, where the BMD gains are on par with alendronate. The reason for the potent anabolic effect of romosozumab is thought to be because of its dual anabolic and anti-resorptive activity, which gives it a larger anabolic activity window. In contrast, for example, teriparatide, whilst able to enhance bone formation, at the same time also increases bone resorption due to the coupling of osteoclast and osteoblast activity. The gap between anabolic activity and anti-resorptive activity for teriparatide is reduced. Similar to the other osteoporosis drugs, romosozumab is most potent for the spine and less potent at the hip, but still is more potent than the other osteoporosis agents, including denosumab and teriparatide, with regards to BMD gains. And fracture risk reduction has also been separately verified with romosozumab at the spine and the hip. The reason why osteoporosis drugs are more effective for the spine than the hip are because the spinal skeleton is more metabolically active than the hip bone, with a larger surface area because of the spongy bone microarchitecture, and so BMD changes will show more quickly than at the hip bone, which is more dense with a smaller surface area. It is given as monthly subcutaneous injections, but for now, these have to be done by a healthcare professional, unlike teriparatide, which can be self-administered. This is because the administration of romosozumab is more fiddly, as the 210mg dose is required to be divided into two syringes, which need to be injected into two different injection sites. Its use is limited to 12 months, because after 1 year, its effects begin to wane. And then it should be followed by an anti-resorptive to maintain the bone mineral density gains, otherwise the BMD returns back to baseline in 1 year's time. So there is a study which shows that if you use denosumab, the BMD continues to increase, whereas if you switch over to a bisphosphonate, the BMD is just maintained. So we could take a look at the charts here. So these are the charts for the lumbar spine BMDs. These are using data from the two separate studies. And after 1 year, the BMD gains from both are pretty similar, around 13 to 14%. So it does seem okay to compare the two charts like this. And it does show that BMD gains after two further years of denosumab are higher, that is at 18% above baseline, than that for alendronate, which seems to have stayed about the same, maybe higher at around 15%. So it could be argued that the difference between the two, whilst significant, is not huge. Although when you look at the charts for the hip BMDs, again, it's around a 3-point difference between the two, but perhaps it could be argued that percentage-wise, it's a more significant difference as the initial BMD gain with the romosozumab was smaller at 6%. In any case, if a patient has already achieved their target BMD after 1 year of romosozumab, then switching to a bisphosphonate would be sufficient. And if a patient were to transition from romosozumab to denosumab, and then if they were to later stop denosumab, they would have to be switched to a bisphosphonate to reduce the risk of rebound vertebral fractures, which is associated with stopping denosumab. A course of romosozumab can be repeated after a certain duration of time, although there currently isn't any clear guidelines for how long this gap should be between courses. Romosozumab has some minor common side effects, arthralgia, headaches. There is a possibility that romosozumab may increase the risk for cardiovascular incidents, as this was observed in one of the major trials. Although there is conflicting data, as some trials have also not reported any noticeable risk for cardiovascular events. Sclerostin is expressed within smooth muscle vasculature, but other than this, it's not known why blocking it might cause cardiovascular incidents. More real-world data is required to verify if there is a link between romosozumab and cardiovascular disease. To be on the safe side, for now there is a black box warning for romosozumab that it should not be used in patients who have cardiovascular disease. And then very rarely, similar to the other osteoporosis drugs, it may cause osteonecrosis of the jaw and atypical fracture. Like the other osteoporosis drugs, prior exposure to anti-resorptive therapies will blunt the effects of romosozumab. And actually, denosumab blunts the effects of romosozumab even more than alendronate does, which is in contrast with what happens if you give denosumab after romosozumab. This shows the importance of taking into account how osteoporosis drugs should be sequenced. Because it's still very new, romosozumab is currently only licensed for osteoporosis in postmenopausal women. The Endocrine Society updated its osteoporosis clinical practice guideline in 2020. They recommend romosozumab for postmenopausal osteoporosis in women with a very high risk of fracture, such as those with severe osteoporosis. And then there's some technical guidelines. So the treatment should be up to 1 year and to avoid in women at high risk of cardiovascular disease or stroke. And then when stopping, is switching to an anti-resorptive after 1 year. To recap, romosozumab is a relatively new monoclonal antibody which came out in 2019. It targets sclerostin. Apart from the parathyroid hormone analogs, it is the only other anabolic agent available and the only agent with dual activity. It is currently the most potent anti-osteoporosis drug at increasing BMDs at the spine and the hip within 1 year, which is attributed to its dual anabolic and anti-resorptive activities. And like the other osteoporosis agents, it is more effective at the spine than the hip. Fracture risk reduction has also been separately assessed and verified. However, its use is limited to 1 year due to its effects waning after 1 year, after which the patients should be switched to either a bisphosphonate or denosumab to maintain the bone mineral density gains achieved. It is given as a monthly subcut injection, which needs to be administered by a healthcare professional. Its effects are blunted if given after a bisphosphonate, and even more so if given after a course of denosumab. However, if you give antiresorptives after a course of romosozumab, they can effectively maintain the bone mineral density gains achieved, and in the case of denosumab, may even continue to increase BMD gains at the spine and hip. Romosozumab seems generally well tolerated, other than headaches and arthralgia and injection site reactions, but there is a concern with cardiovascular incidents that still needs to be verified. And for now, its use is not recommended in patients at high risk of cardiovascular disease and stroke. And like the anti-resorptives, it is associated with the rare incidence of atypical fracture and osteonecrosis of the jaw. In the European guidelines, its role is reserved for postmenopausal women with osteoporosis who are at very high fracture risk, including severe osteoporosis and multiple vertebral fractures. And that's it for this video on Romosozumab. Hope you found it helpful. Please check out the other videos in the osteoporosis series if you haven't already. And just a reminder that this video is for education purposes only and should not be taken as medical advice. Thank you for watching.